Good morning and happy Sabbath. We're so glad you all are here to worship with us this morning.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began.
Welcome back to all of our students and families who were gone for spring break. Whether you traveled far or stayed somewhat local, we are thankful to have you back and hope you got some much needed rest. Tomorrow night, there's Women's Ministries, and they're having their Women's Night starting at 5 p.m., and there will be a meal, conversation, and Joe Dubs will be speaking to the group. If you want to go, please RSVP to Brittany Woods. Also, Soup Kitchen is next week, and we will be assembling sack lunches at 9 a.m., and if you would like to help by purchasing necessary ingredients, please sign up through the newsletter. To help with packing and delivering lunches, please contact Brittany Woods. Lastly, Alumni Weekend is next weekend, and we will have a lot of guests joining us for worship, making it necessary for us to meet at the Wally Fox Wellness Center for the worship service. And we will also be starting at 10:45 a.m., so a little bit earlier, and children and adult Sabbath schools will start, and they will meet at the church. And now Ms. Chatora has something to share.
Good morning. Sorry, I've got quite a stack here. My sister actually used to call me the book lady, the bag lady, sorry, because before the advent of Kindle and things like that, I always traveled with a bag full of books, so bear with me for a second. Okay, so I'm up here this morning to talk to you about the library, and I just want to say that the library is really coming together. We're really excited about it, and I want to thank all of you who have donated either funds or used books or given of your time and your effort to help me put the library together. We've got some really exciting things going on. I just wanted to highlight a couple of the things. This month, we have focused on ordering cookbooks. So we have gotten several new vegan cookbooks. We've got Simple Green Meals. We've got La Vida Verde, which is really good. I've actually cooked from this cookbook. It's all vegan Mexican food. Delicious. There's even a cool recipe in here for horchata negra, which I had never had before, but it's like black horchata. Very good. This one is called Plant Over Processed. It's vegan. It's actually also gluten-free, so this one is awesome. There are some delicious chocolate chip cookies in here. My kids eat them like crazy, and they're made out of chickpeas and maple syrup and peanut butter. Really good. This one I have not read yet, but I understand they have quite a following on Instagram, and it looks really good. So if you like Korean food, this one's called The Korean Vegan. It's actually recommended by Mariana in the office. So thank you to that, to Mariana for that. And also, oh, thank you. Yeah, you can actually take these ones. Thank you. The last one I have here is called Eat Plants, Feel Whole. And this was actually published by Advent Health Press. And this is really good. This is sort of like a beginner's guide to curing chronic disease through your diet. And it's really great. I've also cooked from this cookbook. Really great vegan sausage patty recipe that's made out of oatmeal and cashews. Delicious. So I like to cook, too, so I'm excited to see all the cookbooks. I actually, which leads me to my next thing that I wanted to talk about, which was all of the evangelism books. So part of the vision that we had for the library was not just reviving the library, but also reviving our literature evangelism ministry. And so I've been really thankful to have the help of Pastor David and Mariana in the office helping me to order materials. And I just wanted to share personally that the reason why I'm standing in front of you today is because someone gave me an Adventist cookbook. And it sat on my shelf for years before I started getting interested in nutrition. And I was actually in college when I finally pulled that book off the shelf and learned about God and how much he cares for us. And I filled out a Bible studies card at the back of the Adventist cookbook, and here I am today. So I do believe in the literature ministry, and I do believe that it's important. So I just wanted to highlight real quick, we ordered Bible studies. So we have It Is Written Bible studies, we have Amazing Facts Bible studies, we have children's Bible studies, we have Bible studies in Spanish, we have different sharing books, we have books on all different topics. So I've been trying to give out things that do like align with people's interests. So I've been going to the library, story time at the public library in Calhoun, and so I've given copies of Education by Ellen White to homeschooling moms who have questions about homeschooling. I've given copies of The Great Controversy to people. I've given Bible storybooks to people who are looking for something more wholesome to read to their children in light of what's happening in the world. So it doesn't have to be, you know, these are great, these magazines, we've got a bunch of these in. This one is actually in Spanish, Daniel y Apocalipsis, but it's Daniel and Revelation in English. It's all about Daniel and Revelation and the prophecies. It's got beautiful pictures and explanations. We've got a bunch of these, but it doesn't have to be something like this. You can tailor your gift to someone, to their interests and what they might want to pick up. We also have copies of The Great Hope, which is sort of an abridged version of The Great Controversy. Which leads me to, we did order a bunch of copies of The Great Controversy, and these, I have been surprised. Sometimes I can be very timid about giving this book out because, you know, it's a heavy book and there's a lot of information in here. But I have been very surprised at how receptive people have been. People that I have built friendships and relationships with that I've just said, hey, there's this great book and I want you to have it. It's a gift. And they have received it warmly and said, oh, some people even said, oh, I've heard of this book. I'm so happy you gave it to me. I'm going to read it. And so don't be afraid. Don't be shy. I just wanted to share real quick before I go. There was a quote that I was reading in Last Day Events, the book by Ellen White. And it talks about this particular book, The Great Controversy. And it says, the results of the circulation of this book are not to be judged by what now appears. By reading it, some souls will be aroused and will have courage to unite themselves at once with those who keep the commandments of God. But a much larger number who read it will not take their position until they see the very events taking place that are foretold in it. The fulfillment of some of the predictions will inspire faith that others will also come to pass. And when the earth is lightened with the glory of the Lord in the closing work, many souls will take their position on the commandments of God as the result of this agency. And I just wanted to say, like, the literature ministry is super, super important. And much like someone also shared a quote with me about how in the last days, people will be taking these books off their shelves. They might have had them for years, but something will happen to awaken their heart and they'll pull them off the shelves. And they'll read them, and God's love will reach them through those books. Those books can go where we cannot. The Holy Spirit works through those books. And like I say, it's so personal to me because that's how I'm standing here today. So I just want to encourage you. That's what the library is there for. Come see what we've got. Come see what you can share, and come see what you can read with your family. Thank you so much for all of you for supporting the library.
Books, and I'm wondering if I could have one of these library books, and Jessica said no. Mariana beat you to it. She has dibs on it. So if you want a library book, move fast, and you can maybe beat me to some of the good ones, but feel free to take a look through the library, and thank you, Jessica. Pastor Ben, I'm going to invite you to come up front, and while you're doing that, a little bit of business to take care of. We have some names to vote on. First, we have outgoing names. This is the Leapers, Don and Ruth Ann, and they're transferring to Adairsville, where I'm sure they will bless the Adairsville Church. But we need a motion on that. Someone willing to move, and then I see a second. All in favor of transferring them to Adairsville Church, we will send our blessings on their way. But also coming in, we have a new member. And let me just tell you a little bit of the background. Earlier this summer, I met a new family who moved here all the way from Miami. Anyone from Miami here today? Yeah, we've got a few Miami people. And that was Rainier. Rainier, I'm going to have you stand up. Rainier and his mom, Romelia, who's sitting beside him. You can stand up too. Yes, we're very excited that they're here. Thank you, guys. You can sit down. Rainier begged me to come up front and speak, and I said, no, you can't do that. I'm going to make you stay over there. Anyway, we're super excited that they moved here this last summer. Rainier is a freshman here at GCA. Like many of you, that was the reason to come here, was they wanted to be a part of this community, be a part of this school, and Rainier, we're thankful that you're here, and now Rainier has made the steps to become a member here at this church. And we need a motion on that to accept him into membership. Is there a motion? Seconds? All in favor? Rainier, thank you for coming here. We're excited to have you as a part of this church family officially. And now, Pastor Ben, I made you stand up here for a little bit. This afternoon, there's something exciting happening, something that I'm planning to be at. But Pastor Ben, can you tell us a little bit about what's happening and who's invited to what you're doing?
Well, this church has as a primary mission helping people become totally committed followers of Jesus Christ or disciples. And this afternoon we are starting a three-part presentation from 3 to 5:30 this afternoon, and then 2 weeks from today, and then the 14th of May we'll have the last two sessions. And during these three sessions we are going to be exploring what it means to walk close with Jesus, how to find the excitement and the joy, not of just longing for heaven and waiting for heaven, but learning to walk with Jesus now, here, and having him transform our lives. I will guarantee you that if you will follow the processes we will be exploring this afternoon, your life will change. You'll go deeper with him than you ever thought was possible. The reason I can say this is I've watched what it's done in my own life, in my wife's life. I've watched what it did in my church back in Paradise, California, where I pastored for 13 years. And I saw people's lives change dramatically as they began to integrate Christ into every area of their lives. And we're going to be talking about that these three weekends and giving you some very practical skills of how to make it happen. Oh, you said, who's it for? Everybody. There'll be those of you who are young people here, if you can come, you'd be welcome. And if some of you don't feel like you can come back out this afternoon, it is available online. It will be online and in the announcements that came out from David's office. There is a link to the Zoom connection.
Awesome. Thank you very much. That's enough time for you to go home, get your lunch, maybe even a nap, and then come back here. And we'll have some refreshments, too, because everything's better with a little bit of food. So be back here at 3 o'clock and grow in your walk with Jesus. And then finally, now you guys are finally released. We have a little thing called nominating committee coming up. And you may have... And so now we're bringing the sheets right into your hands right now so that you have this thought in your head that I want to put a name down here, a name of a student, a name of a community member, someone that you think knows our community well and who can help suggest names to help us connect people in ministry. We're not going to collect that right now, but just keep that with you. Write a name down, and then on your way out the door, there's a basket out there that is for our names. You can just drop it in that marked basket on the table on your way out the door. So thank you for doing that. And now, finally, it is time for our children's story. Children, please come up. Mrs. Peterson has a story for you.
Thank you. Good morning. How are you guys this morning? Good? Everybody's a little shy, a little quiet. Well, I wanted to talk to you guys about when I was growing up, we would have some really good worship stories on Friday and Saturday night. Oftentimes, they were mission stories, and they could get very exciting because sometimes there was a story about somebody being saved from the jaws of a crocodile. And sometimes a snake might slither into a baby's room in the jungle. And sometimes there was a tiger that would come into the jungle. They were very exciting mission stories. And even though these people were far off in the jungle or in Africa, usually had a pretty good ending. They were there to tell people about Jesus. Some of the titles of these stories might be Gunga and the Tiger. Or it might be Out of the Jungle. Or this one here, I'm not too sure about, The Man Who Loved Cannibals. I'll let you guys talk to your parents about that over lunch, okay? In all the excitement, there were prayers that were answered, and the missionaries shared God's love with the people that they were being missionaries to. So I was getting my story together today, and I thought, man, is there a missionary that I know that I can tell you guys about? And the perfect people popped into my head. You may not know them, but I have a picture I brought with me today. This is the Nettleberg family. And the wife, the mom there's name is Danae. She was at Southern at the same time that I went to school. She went off to medical school and met her husband, Olin, and they became medical doctors way over in Africa. And look, they ended up with five cool kids while they were over there. They have just returned to the States, and they had served 11 years over there. And while I followed them on Facebook, I would see all kind of pictures of surgeries that they would do and tumors that they would remove off of the mission of the people who lived there. They did some crazy stuff. And while they were there, they were sharing God's love with other people, which I thought was really cool. There's one more picture of the Nettleberg family here with some of the natives. And I know they're happy to be back in the States, but I know they miss the people that they were serving over there. So I started thinking about a missionary. These are people that went way over to another country. The very definition of a missionary is somebody who has a mission, and they are going on a religious mission to tell people probably about what they believe in. And I thought, you know what? We've got some missionaries right around here. These kids, the academy kids that you see a lot of out here in the congregation, they go to school here, and a lot of times they have opportunities to go on mission trips. They're going to tell other people about Jesus. And I thought, you know what? Whether you're going to Africa, whether you're going to Kentucky, whether you're going to Utah, or whether you're right here in Calhoun, Georgia, you guys have the opportunity to be a missionary. You may be really good with tools, and you want to help build a church. Or maybe one day you'll be a medical person, and you'll want to go and help heal people. Or maybe you're really good with kids and can sing, and you would do a VBS for kids. The possibilities are really just endless. So I thought it would be fun to have a quiz, because I'm not the one taking the quiz. I'm going to give it to you guys. That's why I thought it would be fun. I'm going to give you guys a quiz. We're going to put some more pictures up here on the screen, and maybe some of the big kids out in the audience will help you guys out. When the picture shows up, I'm going to tell you who is on that picture and what they're doing, and if it's somebody who's a missionary, I want you to say, amen, okay? If it's somebody that's on the screen who you don't think is a missionary of what we talked about, I want you to say, nope. All right? You got it? Missionary? Amen. Not a missionary? Nope. Okay. Let's go to our first slide here. This is Libby and Dennis Seal. They're my parents. And they've got a little baby there. That's my oldest brother. they went and served in Monument Valley, Utah for 3.5 years. And my dad, one more slide there, was a dentist to the Navajo Indians. Do you think they were missionaries? Amen. All right, next slide. This little girl's name, you guys might know. Her name's Addie. And there's a little guy there, and that's Sammy. And they went and served some people in Kentucky. Do you think they were missionaries? Amen. Oh, I see somebody there. You guys may know. I see a little face looking back. I think her name is Eden. She went on a trip to Africa with GCA, and I think she helped maybe with a VBS. Do you think she's a missionary? Amen. This one was just taken a few years ago. This is my aunt and uncle, Mary and Ben Maxson. He was just up front, and their daughter, Laura. They were missionaries. Oh, I gave it away. Amen. They served in Uruguay and Argentina for 3 years. Missionaries? Oh, that was a giveaway. All right. Oh, this is somebody in our church, the Chatura family. They lived in Zimbabwe for 2 years, and he had a job over there. And you know what? Even though Miss Jessica said we weren't necessarily missionaries, we still talked about Jesus over there. Missionaries? Amen. Amen. Oh, do you guys know these big people? We had to sneak some of these guys in here. This is Caleb and Junior. And I think Caleb is preaching, and Junior was translating on a trip that they just took recently to Puerto Rico. Yeah. Oh, Dominican, thank you. Missionaries? Yeah. Amen. All right, next slide. This is Chi and Lyra. They're doing a VBS for some kids. Missionaries? Yeah. Amen. This is my cat. Missionary? Yeah. Nope. He sure is cute, though. These are some GCA church members and some family members visiting, doing soup kitchen that comes around every few months. Missionaries? Yeah. Amen. This is Cameron and Zoe and Avery and Xander helping out at a school cleanup across the street. Missionaries? Yeah. Amen. These are some people you guys might see every day, our Coble staff that talk about Jesus to you guys. Missionaries? Yeah. Amen. Oh, my friend Reagan here is painting a sign on her trip to the Dominican. Missionary? Yeah. Amen. This is Zach. He has been serving almost a year down in Bolivia at an orphanage and a school. Missionary? Amen. Stay with me. We're almost there. This is the Smith family. They moved from a faraway land in the Northwest and came to the very exciting jungles of Calhoun, Georgia, to share Jesus with the community. Missionaries? Oh, I'm so glad. These are Calhoun and GCA Church Pathfinders singing up front at Calhoun Church a few weeks ago. Missionaries? Amen. This is a cool meerkat. Missionary? Yeah. Oh! We're almost there. This is Patricia and Wayne Darville, and we've got one more slide of them. They have helped rebuild homes and churches in the Caribbean on Long Island and New Providence when a hurricane came a few years ago and destroyed much of the island. But Dr. Darville has been working over the past 40 years going back down there and helping improve the lives there. Missionary? Amen. Amen. This is Gavin. He got up front and gave a sermon at Pathfinder Sabbath. Missionary? Amen. All right. This is Braden. He also got up and shared a testimony at Pathfinder Sabbath. Missionary? Amen. Amen. And our last one here, this is Don Keel. He's been helping GCA students on mission. Oh, oops, I did it again. Serve in Kentucky. He has done 35 trips in 28 years helping the people in Kentucky rebuild their homes and do projects. You know what? No matter where you are or where you go, how long you stay there, you can be a missionary by sharing God's love. Let's say a quick prayer. Bow your heads. Thank you, Jesus, that we can serve you no matter where we are. Be with us as we go through the rest of this Sabbath. Amen.
You know, it's hard to believe that it was now just over a month ago on a Thursday, February 24, that we first heard the news about the invasion in Ukraine. And I think most of us have really been kind of caught up with this, kind of following a tragedy unfold in real time before our eyes, and it's been impactful to a lot of people. But Lexi, I wanted to talk with you this morning because I think you have probably had a different kind of reaction and a different kind of connection to that than most of us have. So can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, so I was actually born in Western Ukraine, in Khmelnytsky. And my brother was born in Eastern Ukraine, in Donetsk, which has now been like destroyed. And on my dad's side of the family, there's a lot of Ukrainian heritage. So it's definitely always been a part of my life. And so now seeing it kind of happening is really definitely very hard. So yeah.
Yeah, so it kind of ties your heart a little bit closer than for a lot of people. You know, that Sabbath that first happened, a lot of you weren't here because there was another program taking place, or a couple programs taking place, but we had Pastor Gary from the conference office. He was preaching that Sabbath, and something that he mentioned has really stuck with me, and that's also that we have a church connection to Ukraine, that there's about 43,000 Adventists that live in Ukraine, and we have 43,000 Adventist members in Georgia-Cumberland Conference. And so kind of this little interesting parallel of this kind of connection to our brothers and sisters over there. And obviously that doesn't change like our affections. It doesn't matter who's suffering when we look at suffering throughout the world. But it does somehow just bring it home a little bit closer when you think about people going through the same kind of rhythms of life that we're going through today happening in Ukraine. So tell me a little bit about why, when we think about what's happening, like obviously whenever there's war, there's suffering, there's a lot of destruction and death, but there's been a lot of requests for funding for us to be able to support people in Ukraine. Tell me what's going on there, why people need support, or what are some things happening? What's the crisis in Ukraine?
So if you literally just search anywhere on the internet, you can see pictures of all the terrible things that have happened. Obviously, like Pastor David said, in war, there's always going to be people that shouldn't be affected that are. But it's just been absolutely terrible because of the fact that the oppressor is a lot bigger of a country. And so families are just being torn apart. Their country, like the land physically, is just being absolutely destroyed. And so it's just terrible. People are trying to flee and can't, places that they're trying to take shelter in are being bombed. And so it's just, they're in desperate need of anything they can get. They're even just lacking like food and like basic like toiletry items. So like just natural things that we just have, they're just lacking right now. So definitely a need.
And this is something that GCA as a school has seen and wanted to respond. Tell me what GCA has been doing.
Yeah, so we actually have an opportunity we're raising money for ADRA because they're doing, they're fundraising for Ukraine as well, just for humanitarian things like that, like food, like I was saying, shelter. And so we're doing that. There's actually a box that we brought over. It's usually in campus ministries, but we brought it over here today. So that's an option for you guys if you wanted to donate there.
And so I guess, first of all, thank you to students. I know a lot of you have already been giving of your own resources to support this fund. And now this is an opportunity for members. There's actually two ways that you can give. There's multiple ways that the church is getting involved with this. One is through ADRA, and that's what that box, if you put loose offering in that box, that'll go straight to ADRA. Chaplain Josh was having a conversation with them about that, like where does this money actually go? There's a lot of needs throughout the world that ADRA takes care of, and they assured him that the current funding that they're doing goes straight to Ukraine. That's the current crisis that they're pouring their resources into. So if you give to that, that's going to Ukraine. If you give through online giving, you'll notice on your tithe envelope through online giving, there's a new button there for Ukraine. And if you give through that, that goes to the division in Ukraine, the Adventist Church, and it goes through the Adventist Church, also, again, straight through helping out with humanitarian needs there. So as we think about how we live with our resources, consider what you can do to help other people through this as God is calling you to do it. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for giving us the opportunity in life to interact with people. And as we lift up our brothers and sisters throughout the world in different kinds of needs, particularly with Ukraine, we just pray that you will bring the resources necessary, that you will alleviate the pain, and that you will bring peace. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
As we sing this song, I invite you all to listen to the lyrics because it has a really good message of how God not only loves us and gives us a second chance, but everybody around the world, no matter our background and no matter where we come from.
Come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world.
Kneel down as far as possible for prayer. Dear Heavenly and Gracious Father, thank you for this day, Lord. Thank you for all the opportunity to be here and worship you. Please be with the students speaking today. Give them strength and guidance and help them to be bold in speaking the word. Please be with the church members with their illnesses and struggles. Help them and guide them through and give them so much strength. Please be with the people in Ukraine, with the refugees. Help them in all they do. Give them so much strength so they can get through this hard time. Thank you, Lord, so much. In your precious and holy name I pray. Amen.
Good morning, church, and happy Sabbath. What an honor to be here today. My honor to be here today and tell you something about how this idea started on going to Dominican Republic. So I know about Hostos Church since the beginning. Hostos is a daughter of my home church in the Dominican Republic at the north side of the island. And people from Hostos used to attend to my church. That church is like maybe 6 or 7 miles from my hometown church. So the pastor and my mother, a few more people, was thinking, we should do something, because those people have problem with transportation to go to church every Sabbath, and they only was able to go on Sabbath. We have service Wednesday, Friday, and other things. So they was missing church, basically. So they was thinking to buy some land, but the main problem was money. No, only a few members was working. You know, those little towns, there's not a lot of money go to church, to the fund. So they get together, they start praying, and they was able to get this land like probably 30 years or so ago. Everything started when I went to Dominican Republic to visit and have a class reunion. I graduated from high school in 1986, and we never get together after that. So we get together, we was having so much fun, and Sister Nidia Marmolejos, who grew up with me, we went to school together, went to church together. I asked her, hey, Sister Nidia, how's church? And she told me, you know, Inez, the church is literally falling apart. If we have bad weather, we're not able to open the church because we are so afraid that the church fall apart on us one day. And I was like, I wish I can do something for them. That was like 4 years ago. So when I came right back, I spoke to Mr. Garapi, and I said, Garapi, do you think the possibility that we can go to Dominican Republic 1 year? And he was, okay, let's think about it, but just like that. So I called Sister Nidia and asked her for get together and start praying. Because I talked to Mr. Garapi, he didn't say no. So if he didn't say no, I was like, it is possible. So they start praying, and then Garapi said, okay, tell me about it. So we get together, my husband, my sister, and start planning. My sister made the plans, the blueprints, and everything, but then the pandemic. So when we have like a little hope, the pandemic was like, you know, everything was impossible to go. So I called those people. It was really sad for me. Oh, we're not going to be able to do it this time because the pandemic. And there was, okay, we're going to continue praying. So they pray so much. They fast. They start week of prayer and many, many things. Praying for the people who one day, they was like, with so much hope that one day we're going to go to Dominican Republic, Hostos, to build this church. So after many, many prayer, we decide, and then we continue again with the plans to go to Dominican Republic Hostos. Those people are really grateful, and I am pretty sure that it was my experience 35 years ago when Maranatha built my own church. I still thanking God. I still grateful for those people who went to my home church and built. So people in Hostos are very, very thankful, and I'm pretty sure they're going to continue prayer for every missionary who went to put something. Everyone who went gives so much, not only the money, not only the effort, but they give love, they meet people, they, you know, encourage people, they pray. So thank you for everybody to be part of the mission trip last spring break.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Thank you so much, Ms. Garcia, for sharing. In honor of something I learned in the Dominican Republic, which is the people of Hostos, the church, the Adventist people there, they pray a lot. And so this morning I want to pray for those of us who are going to be sharing and start off with that. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you that we are here in this community at the Georgia-Cumberland Academy Church, specifically today, with the opportunity to go and share and minister to those in countries other than our own. I ask that you help us to continue to keep the mindset of connecting with you as much as we can and connecting with those around us as much as we can to make a positive impact on their lives every day. Amen. So the Dominican Republic, this is a new place for me to go. I had never been on a GCA mission trip, and for 1 minute here, once again, I want to thank the staff that came with the students on this trip for making it such a good trip. Can we get a hand for them? I like to try and think of what a trip like this would feel like for other people. So thinking of staff coming on this trip, I'm just sitting there wondering, you know, what are they thinking sitting on the same plane with kids? You know, we're just going to help do what we're told to do. These staff need to come up with ideas of what we need to be doing and stuff like that. And they have to actually be responsible for high school students throughout a week of break. And that just doesn't sound exciting to me, but I was so impressed and impacted by the devotion that those staff members and people that came to help had on the trip, and it inspired me to work harder and get a lot done. So for my experience on the trip, I worked mostly at the construction site with a couple of days of VBS in between, so I'm going to share just a couple of specific memories about that. So at the construction site, which I think you'll get a visual for at the end of everyone speaking this morning, it's just a long stretch of land, and when we get there, all that is there is like the foundation, a couple courses of block, and a roughly poured cement slab. And Mr. Garcia had understood the plans and was telling us what needed to be done, but we had no, you know, area professional help, if you understand what I'm saying. So it's a bunch of Americans going to a foreign country looking at blocks that are made out of mostly sand, because if you dropped them, they just disintegrated, and you just kind of kicked it into the ground. It was a different experience for me to be working with materials that just weren't quite the same. So there was a learning curve to that. And so for the first day of work, we probably laid, I'm not even sure, 40 block maybe. And we finished the day, and I hear that there's going to be some sort of service going on. So all of the people from the other groups, the VBS and the other ministries and from the home camp that were making food came to the construction site, and we're all standing there waiting to see what happens. And then all of a sudden, a bunch of the local Hostess Church members, if I understand correctly, they come out and they started singing to us. And there was a translator there translating what they were saying. They're saying, thank you so much. Thank you so much for being here. And I know I shared the same thought with a couple of people standing, you know, right next to a church that has like 30 blocks up, and then there's like 6 pallets of block just sitting there waiting to be put in. And, you know, you're standing there, oh, wow, this is incredible. And you feel so fed by these people that are so thankful. But you're thinking, we got like 7 work days left? You know, there's a lot of block there. And it impressed me that the people there were so pleased to have us. Something else that I learned about kind of how buildings work there in the Dominican Republic is that work is slow, because people are paid by the day, usually. This is how I understand it. And so there's not much incentive to build something quickly, because the slower you do it, as long as the employer is still willing to pay you, you have work for the next day. And so it was incredible to see, I think there was probably 5 or 6 on-site, I'm going to call them professionals, they worked very quickly when we were there, that were working very hard to get this church done. And they taught us a lot. Even without understanding the language, I was able to get to kind of understand, you know, even character traits about people. You know, they're happy on the job, you know, some of the guys. Other ones were real serious, just laying block, going all day. But I'm gonna share one specific experience about building, which is my dad came on the trip, and he met with this guy whose name was Sandy. And Sandy had 3 or 4 communication signals that he used with my dad, which neither of us speak any Spanish. And I'm going to see if I can do these right. So this is enough. This is wait. Like, you know, and if eyes get big, it's like stop. Just hang on. Wait, slow down. We don't need to move this quickly. And this is bring. And then it was incredible. He would take, like, I don't even know, he'd pick up a rock. And from me to halfway through the audience, throw it and it would hit the item that he wanted, whether it was a block or a hammer or a trowel or a bucket with mortar in it. He'd throw boop, and it would hit the item, and you'd go and get it and bring it to him. And then he would smile at you and give you a fist bump, and he'd wink all the time. And it made a connection with the guy working, you know, who you can tell has done this same thing for 40 years probably, that he's kind of getting an extra level of enjoyment out of working with the Americans, you know. And I know some people probably were bothered by it, but my favorite thing is when he'd motion for something, and like I'd go and get it and bring him the completely wrong thing. And just because I didn't use my eyes and look at the situation, you know, I brought him a block when he needed more concrete. And then they talk back and forth, a couple of the workers, and they all start laughing at us. And then he picks up the rock and throws it at the thing that he wants. And it really makes you feel kind of silly. But that was really cool, being able to laugh and, you know, make connections with the guy even when you're working. And it made the work quite easy. And about easy work, I didn't realize, I've done a lot of projects over the last few years, just working for side money, building retaining walls, stuff like that. So this is not new work to me particularly, but usually it's hot and it's hard work. And I think that having a purpose, and this is what's so amazing about service, having a purpose of what you're doing changes all of that. The heat wasn't half as bad. None of us keeled over from dehydration that I saw, at least. And things just went much quicker, and the work definitely seemed easier. And I think that I now, looking back, even though it would have been awkward, you know, the people that came and sang songs for us and told us how much they appreciated us being there really impacted everyone on the work site, and especially, I know it impacted everyone, but that's where I was, and helped us work quicker. It made the work easy. And so the coolest thing was at the end of the week, you know, we were working pretty slow for the first few days, and then blocks started going up, and then it just kept going quicker and quicker, and we were making different kinds of concrete, mixing it on the ground. That's something I'd never done before. You know, usually you throw it in the cement mixer and wait a little bit, and then you get it out, and you take it in your wheelbarrow and pour it somewhere. But this was completely different. The way that people do things and, you know, how pleased they were to be doing them with outsiders made the work easy once again. But I think the peak of the experience for me was at the end of the week, when at probably 4:30 in the afternoon, the roof just starts being put on. And we had to stop work because they're up there welding, and we had all the block in, and we go to sleep. And I'm thinking, you know, they won't have church there in the morning. This is Friday. And I'm, oh, wow. And we come to church the next day, and the roof is on the building. It was incredible. And I don't know how late they stayed, but I think it was amazing. And being able to sit in pews that were made by the hands of the Americans that came to help, and be able to listen to the message given by the people that were there and impacted in the week inside of a church that was built in that week by the hands of those serving was incredible. And so I really do encourage, like I said, this was my first GCA mission trip that I've been on. Consider it. It's really cool. And you get to see other sides of people that you wouldn't really understand. I'm gonna pick on somebody for just a minute because he's incredible. Junior is so humble. This guy can play the guitar. He speaks. I saw two fluent languages that he used on that trip, and I wouldn't be surprised if there's a third or a fourth. This guy is incredible. And I did give a short testimony at the church, and he's translating these, you know, American phrases that we use that wouldn't make any sense. He's making it make sense to the congregation, and that's incredible to see their faces light up. You know, you say something, and then you wait, and then they understand what's being said. And that's just a really special thing for me and a new experience. So I appreciate, once again, the GCA staff and devoted members for making this trip possible. Thank you.
All right, so good morning, everyone. My name is Cameron Kearsine, and I'm a four-year senior at GCA. And this is my first mission trip I've ever been on. So I just want to share a couple experiences with you guys. I preached at a local church for the first Sabbath, and I've never done that before, so I did that for the first time. And it was definitely a different experience, like, church-wise. We, like, just piled up in a bus and went to this place, and we went to the wrong place at first, and we were just all, like, sitting around, like, I don't know what we're doing. And then so we talked to the bus driver and we went to another place. And then they dropped us off at like this alleyway. So there's like this just in between two buildings, and then they had these tarps over top, like connecting from the buildings. So that was a little sketchy. They're like, okay, the bus left, and then we just walked into that place. And so then we turned around the corner, and at the back of that building, to the right of it, like at the back was this like porch that they kind of built with like a tin roof and like some like plywood, just I don't know, just like pillars. So then we got there and they were just ending their Sabbath school. And so the church was more like a laid back, more nature kind of vibe to it, but also it was very traditional. Like since I was the pastor for the day, I prayed like 20 times and like honestly started running out of things to pray about. But that was it was cool. Like I sat up front, like they're doing like traditional churches, and Zabdi, I don't know if he's here, but he translated for me the whole day and he did a really good job. And so I did that. That was a good experience. And then I also have just one more. I went to VBS a couple times, and it was really cool seeing the kids. Like they were just so excited seeing us. Whenever we pulled up on the bus, they like went like onto the fence, just like grabbing it and like yelling. They were so excited to see us. And like so then we had a good day. And there's one time where like I could tell it was kind of cool seeing you know, you're in a different, pretty much a different world down there, and yet human nature is still the same. At VBS, we were like throwing the ball with some kids, and you know, we were like American and older, so some of them tried to like show off and like throw it really hard and to say that they were strong or something. And then this one time they threw it and it hit a girl in the head, like I was eating lunch sitting there, and they all started laughing, and I was like, okay, that's pretty funny. So it was like, it was cool to see, like, you know, even then, like, that's still a funny thing that happens. And another time that like, human nature is still the same is, like, I work dentist also, like, at the medical. And so during the week, like, a lot of people started coming. So they had to wait a long time. And so by the time they kind of figured out, like, we had a number system. So we would just go by, like, okay, you're patient number 7, so come here. But then they thought that, like, if they move their chairs closer to where they wanted to go, like, they would, like, just move their chairs, like, an inch away from, like, the dentist, like, then they thought that they would go first because then they don't want to wait in line. But no, so then we had to, like, grab the chair and be like, excuse me, you're over here. So it was funny just seeing how, you know, no matter where you are in a totally different country, different place, human nature is still the same. So that's what I learned. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Daniela, and I'm also a 4-year senior. And this was also my first mission trip, and it was, like, really close to home for me just because of the fact that my entire family's from the Dominican Republic. And I mostly translated the entire trip. I worked medical for, like, 2 days, but the rest of the trip I was actually translating for Mrs. Mitchell's seminars and, like, workshops on pelvic health and just, like, the female anatomy. So it was definitely a bit frustrating at the beginning because I didn't grow up saying these scientific words in Spanish and just like anatomy words, so I got really discouraged at first, but it definitely got way easier by the end of the trip. And one of the biggest things was, I'm sorry, I'm like losing what I'm saying. So we were like translating for like big workshops, and it was like all like, it was groups of like high school girls, and there was one where it was like a church and it was filled with like these women. And I just remember learning, like, from a really young age, like, going to the Dominican Republic, that young women in the Dominican Republic are sexualized and just exploited from a really young age because of just, like, the lack of education on, like, that, I guess, that, like, aspect. So I felt really good about it by the end because I was thinking about it in, like, the bigger picture, and I was like, we probably influence at least one girl from making, like, a bad decision or just learning about, you know, their body in a better way. So I'm really happy about that because, you know, in the beginning of the trip, I felt like I wasn't impacting anyone, and I felt really bad about it. I was like, what is the point of me being on this mission trip? Because I was like, you know, I'm not doing any physical labor, which I didn't. I didn't work construction at all. And I was just like, I feel like it was a waste, but by the end, I'm just so happy, and I feel so blessed to be part of, like, you know, the program and working with Mrs. Mitchell in general. But I learned two really big lessons from that trip, which is, the lessons are super cliche, but I'm very happy. The first one is to take life one day at a time. Life there, they call it island time. It's just very slow paced. So, you know, people are like late to everything, which is kind of annoying at times. But people really look at the small things in life and appreciate the small things in life. So I'm really happy. And as someone who's like stressed all the time, and I feel like life in the United States is very fast paced, I'm just happy I got to, you know, learn that because it's calming me down. And another lesson that I learned was to be grateful for everything, just because the financial situation in the Dominican Republic for most people is not that good. And compared to us, we're very privileged. So I find myself complaining about a lot of different things which are really like petty and small. So, you know, I'm just like remembering those things and how happy those people were. And they were truly more inspiring to me. And I felt more blessed by them. So thank you.
Hello, so my name is Christina Sargent. I'm a sophomore here at GCA, and this was my first mission trip. So going into mission trip, I was thinking, like, the biggest thing that I want to do, I really want to make a difference in at least one person's life that I went, that was going to be there. So we get to the actual place we're going to do the mission trip, and the first few work days, I was, like, really struggling because the language barrier was really challenging. I didn't feel like I was really making connections with the people. And I just didn't feel like I contributed much. But I kept trying. I tried my best to do the most that I could. So then, fast forward to the end of mission trip, Chaplain Josh, he asked us, what is the biggest takeaway that you've gotten? So I'm reflecting on all the things that I did, and I was like, what is the biggest thing that I did? But then I'm thinking back, and I'm like, I feel like a lot of times we go on mission trip, or when you hear it, then you're like, you're always thinking about what you're going to do for people or how you impacted them. But then I'm thinking back and I'm like, a lot of people, they made a bigger impact on myself. And I was so focused on like making a difference in someone else's life that I didn't realize the difference that they had made in my life. Because in tough situations, like the house I was staying in, we had lost power and running water in it. So it was really hard. We couldn't brush our teeth. We couldn't take showers. We couldn't even flush the toilet. But then I was like, I just feel at ease. Like I felt just at peace with it because I was like, I don't even care because I had gotten way more than just like teaching people things. They had done so much for me that I was like, I don't even care that I can't take a shower. And it was just a really eye-opening situation for me, and I was really grateful that I got to go. So that's my biggest takeaway, that doing mission work for other people is a blessing for them, but it's also a blessing for you because you get to receive the blessings that you have impacted on them.
Hi guys, happy Sabbath.
My name is Hannah Wyatt and I'm a junior at GCA. And I had never been out of the country before until this spring break when I went to Dominican Republic with my dad. And it was a life-changing experience. I was able to help out in medical where I checked people in and organized just kind of where people were sitting and stuff with an amazing translator, Ivana. And I also learned to take blood sugar and blood pressure. In the kitchen, I helped make lunch for all other students and parents, and definitely it made me appreciate people who cook for such big groups. I went with Miss Mitchell to assist in her health talk and go to an all-ladies exercise class where I got to see the joy of learning together. I worked in construction where I learned how to do all kinds of things I had never done before, like making sopa with zabdi, which if you don't know, it's like a really soupy concrete. And Mr. Mitchell taught me how to fold an extension cord in this new way, which I was really proud of myself. And my dad taught me how to stucco the baptismal, which was really fun. And my favorite thing I did on the trip was working in VBS. I basically picked up every kid I saw, and I got to sing and play with a ton of students. But no matter where I was working in the DR, there was one thing that every place had in common. That is the Dominican people and their attitude toward life. Whether they were waiting in line to get medicine, laying block with us at construction, laughing at each other for falling off their yoga balls, trying to sing in English, listening to a health talk with a bunch of girls, or anything else, they were always smiling. This is something I noticed more and more throughout the week. It was totally foreign to me. I obviously couldn't speak the same language as them, but we found other ways to communicate. The second I walked into VBS, the kids were running up to me, hugging me, and saying they loved me. At a medical, the lady came to find me after seeing the doctor to give me a hug and a kiss on the cheek just for helping get her checked in. At the high school, students were coming up and trying to have conversations the best they could and get to know us. The atmosphere there was like nothing I had ever experienced before. And this left me with a question. Why are these people so happy? I mean, to me, they have more they could complain about than the people here in America. Their living conditions aren't like ours, and they have fewer job opportunities. They don't get paid as much as us, so why are they so happy? After thinking about this a lot, I concluded that there are a couple reasons. In the DR, they have such a tight-knit community. It seems like everybody knows and loves each other. Another reason is they are happy and content with their lives. They appreciate simpler things that we may totally overlook and not even think of as a blessing, like flushing toilet paper. Lastly, I believe that a lot of them love Jesus so much and make a conscious effort to show that. Whether all the people there I met were Christian, I saw Jesus in all of them. So my new goal is for people to recognize a love and happiness in me and wonder where the source of that is coming from. My hope is to have a love like Jesus and tight-knit community here at GCA like I saw in the DR. In John 13:35, it says, "By this everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another." I went to mission trip hoping to be a blessing on others, and I had no idea the blessing they would be on me.
Hello, friends. I'm Janice Mitchell, and I'm the mother of Marley, a sophomore here at GCA. This was our first mission trip with GCA. During the trip, I had a few roles. So one of them was to oversee the well-being and safety of 8 young ladies with my friend Catherine Meadows. So every evening, we would go off to our house and be responsible for them. I was also responsible for pelvic health community outreach. So before we go on, you need to know that I'm a physical therapist, but I specialize in a specialty area of physical therapy that covers bowel, bladder, and sexual function and dysfunction. So these are frequently taboo topics, even here in the USA, and I had no idea how this would be received in the Dominican Republic. And my husband might have tried to scare me a little bit and say I might go to jail. But I'm still here. So for our community outreach, we had 3 initiatives. Number 1 was female pelvic health education workshops, including but not limited to self-care, period tips, body awareness and empowerment, and acceptance at churches and high schools, with everyone receiving a custom bag that had period products and educational information and some other items. Then we also had a women's only community exercise class, and this was near the church that we were building. And so this was advertised to the community. Come, women, and come exercise and learn about your bodies. And then the third was a health presentation at the evening evangelism series. And so that talk each evening was emphasizing the New START principles of health. So nutrition, exercise, water, sunshine, temperance, air, rest, and trust in God. So each day, my group of 5 to 7 students would go out into the community, visit various schools and churches, lead and participate in the community exercise classes, help make bags, purchase more supplies for making more bags, and assist with the evening evangelism series. I also had 1 to 2 GCA student translators each day. And like Daniela was saying, this was challenging. Okay, so, I'm using complex anatomy terms and complex concepts that even in English, many people haven't heard. And so these wonderful translators were so patient with me every day. And I talk fast, too. So slowing down, and it was a really amazing connection, and they all did an amazing job. So we saw God at work in each of these community outreach projects. Before going on the trip, we were hoping to reach about 300 students,
But by the end of the trip, we ended up passing out over 500 bags and directly reaching over 700 people. So imagine the impact if each one of those people shares this information with one person. Regarding the pelvic health workshops in the churches and schools, Mrs. Garcia and her team in the DR had lined up speaking engagements at churches and high schools across the area, including Seventh-day Adventist schools, but also public high schools, and even a Catholic church. I honestly thought we may have many cancellations or show up at different locations and not be able to get in. That was not the case. To my amazement, people wanted more. We didn't have enough time to do all the workshops that people were requesting. Teachers were calling teachers at other schools and saying, "Hey, bring that lady. We need her to talk to our students." For some of the workshops, the classes were so full. Those classrooms were full. And then there were people lined up in the windows outside the classrooms trying to listen in. It was beautiful. I was amazed at how receptive and appreciative people were for the information that we were sharing. During the presentation at the Catholic Church, I was treading very carefully with my words and my anatomy models. At one point, one of the senior female church leaders on the front row asked a question. To answer it, I would need to go into detail about some pelvic health anatomy. So before answering, I asked if it was okay to use anatomy terms. And she said, "Yes, we need to know the answer so we can be healthier. If you don't teach us, who will? We need this information." So that really touched my heart. That evening, we had exactly 52 bags, and there were exactly 52 women. So it gave our evangelism group that evening extreme satisfaction to know that God cared about even that small of a detail, to make sure that everyone had a bag. Some things about this trip I expected, and others I did not. What I did expect was delicious tropical fruit, gorgeous beaches, welcoming people, and long hours. What I did not expect was that I heard virtually zero complaints from the students. There were many inconveniences that we all experienced, but the students handled the mosquitoes, cold showers, lack of showers, sink showers, close living quarters, hard work, short nights, and everything else with grace and patience. Probably even better than I did some of the time. Catherine? No, we did great. We made it. So parents, you should be proud. I didn't expect to actually have a church or pews to sit on. We started off the week with just concrete blocks and pieces of wood, but that last Sabbath, we were able to worship in a church, and you're going to see those pictures, that we had actually built, and we had beautiful walls and pews, and it was a wonderful experience. I didn't expect to have such incredible support for the pelvic health community outreach that I had from Mr. Garapi and the rest of the GCA team. I halfway anticipated that once he realized everything that went into what I was teaching and sharing, he may try to edit some of the content, but that was not the case. I have never felt more support than I did during this trip. Thank you, wherever you are, Mr. Garapi and team. I also didn't expect to have an overflowing car full of GCA students that volunteered to help me every day. Each one of you students that volunteered helped to contribute in different ways, and I'm grateful for you, and I'll never forget our experiences together. And Mrs. Garcia, I did not expect the support that you and your family gave to this project. So she and her family are very accomplished, and she has a sister that's an attorney, a sister that's a civil engineer. These ladies took vacation leave from their work to come and cook and clean for our group and to do whatever else was needed. And their amazing support to this project is awesome. I debated about sharing this one, but parents, I think you'll appreciate this. So the evening of the first day, I was eating dinner with several of the dads working at construction. And they were talking about what a hard worker Marley was. This is my daughter. they were somewhat surprised that she was tossing concrete blocks and that she was shoveling sand, etc., without wavering and keeping up with the others, and sometimes even outpacing some of the guys. They didn't know until later that she was my daughter. And so as a parent, you never really, really know what kind of work ethic your children will have when they aren't with you. So that was a proud moment for me personally. I also did not expect the development of the deeper level connections with so many people around me. And I believe that was the case for many people in this group. So from the amazing volunteer parents that made the effort to get ice cream and pizza for impromptu birthday parties, to the students helping me with the workshops, exercise classes, and evangelism, as well as the young ladies in my house group and travel group, and the GCA adults that absorbed 10 extra people into their house at midnight, all the other incredibly hardworking parents and staff that gave their utmost. And last but not least, my housemate and co-parent, Catherine Meadows. This was a special trip that will never be duplicated, and after this experience, I really feel like we're all bonded for life. God was visible in so many places, including but not limited to the vibrant colors, the warmth and hospitality of the people, regardless of whether they were Adventists or not. They welcomed us with open arms, and the unwavering patience and smiles of the GCA staff, and the extra watch care that every single person on this group took to look out for the others, make sure everyone was safe. It was a pleasure to work with the GCA students and see their creativity, initiative, and compassion. I'm almost done. There was a lot of poverty where we were, but it was a beautiful life lesson in simplicity and peace for all of us. We don't need things to make us happy. We can't find peace anywhere but Jesus. So many times we get caught up in getting this or doing this or getting that, going there. We forget why we are here and what we are here on this earth to do. God opens so many doors and hearts on this trip. Some we may know, some we may never know. But I will forever be grateful for the blessing of this trip and this opportunity. Thank you.
My name is Bruce Bogus. I had the privilege of being a faculty on this trip. And first, I just want to thank everybody that has shared their testimony today. It really is great to have a trip like this as part of the GCA experience. Just to go back through the vacation Bible schools, the church construction. I was actually in charge of building the pews, which I have to put a shout out to Wayne Thompson for helping with that and his expertise with wood that I don't necessarily have. But it was amazing at the end of the day, or at the end of the week, at the end of the first day, we were like, this will never happen. and Wayne even at one point considered, man, maybe we skip the excursion for the whale watching so that we get these pews done. And then we actually made much more progress than we thought. They said the construction started slow. People have to start to figure things out, and as they do, you get into a rhythm, and the trip kind of comes together. And it really is awesome because you see that in all areas. The medical area, we had medical and dental area that was seeing over 150 patients a day. The pelvic health that Ms. Mitchell had done. All areas here, everything came together for a really awesome trip. And as Andrew talked about, in that first day when we sit and you look and there's two courses of block and that's it, and you think, how is this going to happen? To Friday when we're pushing to try to get the pews done and try to get the block and they're stuccoing, and late in the day the roof starts to go on and we think, no way, you know. And then that Sabbath morning we all bust down there. And for the record, it rained Sabbath morning during church. And here we were, covered roof, in pews, you know, all those people that had come and sang and were thankful for us, they're there worshiping with us. And like I said, when I think about the GCA experience, We always talk about to know, to love, to serve. Here for these kids, they get to know God in a way that you can't anywhere else. You get to know another part of the world that God created. You get to show God's love to other people. You get to experience God's love from those other people. And then ultimately, you get to serve again in a way that you really just can't do anywhere else. It's one of those things that as Andrew said, and Hannah and others, they encourage you as a GCA student, if you get a chance to go on the mission trip, and every year we do this because of how much of an impact it has and such an important part of the GCA experience. So we have put together a video of our trip that has all the different parts in here. We're going to invite you to watch that now.
Saw a world full of trouble. Now I thought, how do we ever get so far down, and how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty and children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven.
If not now, then when?
Thank you, students and parents and staff, for choosing to do something. It's an inspiration. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for your love. Thank you for giving us the chance to share that love with others. May we do that every day. We pray in the name of Jesus. All God's people said, amen.